Hello and welcome to Joy in Our Town, a ministry provided to you from TBN right here in Orlando. And we are so delighted that you've chosen to take 30 minutes of your time to sit and talk about some very, very practical issues in life. You know, one of the things about the kingdom of God is that it's not all about preaching and teaching as it relates to what happens on Sunday. God speaks as much, in fact, more about money than he does about heaven and hell. And today's conversation is going to address the follower of Jesus and their finance. And so today I'd like for you to welcome with me Charlie Fitzgerald. Good morning, Charlie. It's nice to have you with us today. Thanks for joining us. You are a follower of Jesus.
I am.
And you are a man that has educated yourself in administration and finance. Is that correct?
That's correct.
Where did you get your education at?
University of Florida is where I went to school. Actually, UCF for my two-year degree, and then transferred to Florida and got my degree in finance.
And what motivated you to want to be a part of finance?
You know, my dad was a medical doctor here in Orlando, and I had the choice of going into the world of health or the world of wealth, and I leaned more towards money.
Did you?
Yes.
And so now you're a certified financial planner, and that means that you spend your time talking to people like me and those that are viewing our program today, talking to them about money, and specifically you're talking to them about debt. So let's get right into it. We're living in a crucial time. Would you agree that finances are everybody's big concern? So what is debt, and specifically consumer debt, and why should we be concerned about it?
Well, there's two answers for that question that come to mind. One is a textbook answer of what consumer debt, and the other is a gut kind of answer to what consumer debt is. So from a textbook standpoint, consumer debt is two parties entering into an agreement. One needs money, one has money, right? So you have the loan, the lender, and you have the borrower. They're going to agree to the terms of the loan. It'll have an interest rate. It'll have payments. It'll be, you know, once per month make a payment. And then there's consequences. If the borrower does not satisfy the terms of the agreement, then you could have a car repossessed, or you could have a home foreclosed upon. So essentially, that's what consumer debt is.
Good. So that debt, then, how does it affect not only our economy, but how does it affect a person in their thinking process before they enter into that debt?
Well, this is where the problem begins, is that people will enter into debt not thinking about what they're really doing. And this is where planning is so important. My professor at the University of Florida, we just mentioned a second ago, I'll mention his name, Dr. Crum, who I greatly respect, talked about the 7 P's of finance. Prior proper planning prevents pathetically poor performance. And so my family has heard that for the last 25 years repeatedly. They can probably all recite that. But it really gets down to planning and being careful before you enter into any kind of a debt arrangement.
So what people are dealing with in debt, they're basically dealing with credit card debts, they're dealing with car response, foreclosures, all of those things really are the debt issues that you're talking about. If you were to pick out one of those, how would you advise someone to plan as they were, let's say they're going to buy a house or they're going to buy a car.
Right.
So we're talking to students, we're talking to senior adults, people that are right now may have some wealth. What would you advise them as they were getting ready to move into a large purchase such as that?
Well, one of the things you find with the mortgage companies, you're getting, you know, young couples getting ready to buy a house. First thing they'll try to find out is how much can they afford? What's the mortgage that they can afford? And the mortgage broker will do the math and say, well, you know, based on your income, you can afford up to 30% of your income as a mortgage payment, perhaps. And I think the mistake a lot of young people make is they go right to the limit of what the mortgage company says they can afford and not leaving themselves room. And we have to understand that mortgage companies are in the business of renting money. They're in the business of selling your money and making interest off of you. And just because they say that you can have this much doesn't mean you should take full advantage of that. And I think this is where it starts, is people need to think ahead before they just jump in.
Yeah, because if you go to the limit, then the reality is that owning a home is far more expensive than just the mortgage, isn't it? There's insurances,
that's right,
utilities, and all the other events that come along with it in that process. Well, what are some of the most popular measures and statistics regarding consumer debt that's out there that would help our viewer sort of understand why they need to take serious thought to this?
Well, there's a couple things that we look at. One of them would be bankruptcies, and the other one would be foreclosures. Bankruptcies, in 2010, we had 1.6 million bankruptcies. That's a lot. If you think about the number of 350 million people in the United States,
right.
Not everyone, of course, is able to go bankrupt because you have children and things like that.
Right.
But 1.6 million bankruptcies. Now, as of 2015, the number's been cut in half. So that's a good sign that the economy is healing. And you remember the nightmare we went through in 2008,
sure.
2009, the mortgage crisis, the real estate crisis. So that's a good sign that bankruptcies are coming down. The other one would be foreclosures on mortgages. And at the peak of the decline in the real estate market, we had over 4 million foreclosures
wow.
that occurred in 1 year, I think it was 2011. And the level of foreclosures that were occurring before the whole nightmare happened in 08, 09 was about 1 million per year, so a fourfold increase in foreclosures. So those are some measures that we look at to kind of get a feel for what's happening in the world of debt with the consumer.
And I think that whole problem with the mortgage, the home mortgage is that people were taking on mortgages technically that they really couldn't afford mm-hmm. to handle. Is that correct? Is that what really, again,
well,
people
yes.
got themselves in debt that they couldn't
right.
they couldn't finance, and then the banks and all of that. I know that's a very technical issue, but in that process. So this whole idea of consumer debt, what does it look like in terms of our nation, consumer debt, the outstanding consumer debt that's there?
Well, you'd be shocked to see these numbers. Right now, consumer credit cards, almost $800 billion in consumer credit cards. Student loans, about $1.3 trillion. Automobile loans, well over $1 trillion. And then mortgage debt is about $8 trillion. And you know, one thing I wanted to mention to you is on credit cards for a second.
Right.
Because this is, I think, one of the big danger areas for consumer debt more than anything. And consumer credit cards, they are not backed by any collateral.
Right.
So if you default, you know, they're not going to come after you and take your TV away, right?
Right.
So we got our credit card bill last month, and I was looking at it real carefully. And we owed $1,100 on this credit card bill. The minimum payment was $25.
Mm.
So how long do you think it would take for me to pay that credit card off if I just made minimum payments? Well, I did the math.
Yeah.
Well, actually,
okay.
it's now on the actual statement. They have to provide you the math.
Oh, really? Okay, good.
And it was going to take 7 years.
Wow. I was going to say five.
Of minimum payments
wow.
to pay that credit card off. And at the end of the payment, finally, when I finally got that paid off, that $1,100, the amount of interest that I will pay on that is $2,400 of interest on an $1,100 amount that I borrowed. So this is the craziness of credit cards and making minimum payments. And I like to tell my friends and my clients to pay your credit card balance in full every month and do not run a balance. The rates are, you know, 20%, maybe 30%.
Right.
So they're quite
right.
high.
Why is that so difficult for people,
mm-hmm.
credit cards? Because is it just the consumer, give me, I want it now kind of mentality? Is that what you find when you talk to people? Because
mm-hmm.
I'm sure that people come to you in the crisis, right? I mean, part of your
right.
dealing is that. So what do you find sort of the greatest thing that sort of pulls you in and they need your services? Is it this debt process?
Well, actually, our firm is not dealing with consumer credit counseling per
okay.
se.
Sure.
You know, so we're dealing, helping people manage their finances.
Okay.
And usually the people that are coming to us aren't dealing with debt problems.
Okay.
There are avenues to go to, and we can talk about that maybe a little bit later near the end of this segment. But that, you know, those aren't typically who we're dealing with.
I got you. Yeah. So you're doing sort of the people that are older and they're planning their finances and getting ready, but it's nevertheless important because so many people are struggling with that.
Yes.
Student loans. Would you say student loans, $1.3 trillion.
That's right.
Talk to us because that's easy. Government seems to now want to give everybody this free money to be able to do. Talk to students for a moment
yeah.
that may be watching, our parents
right.
of students that are about ready to move in, or maybe they just did move into college and they're dealing with this. What kind of recommendation would you give to them?
Well, I think the word is caution when it comes to student debt. With as we said, the 1.3 trillion that's out there, there's over 40 million students that are holding all this debt. And the averages per student is somewhere in the $40,000 that when you graduate from college, you're looking at a debt of about $40,000 to be paid off. And these loans are typically being paid off over a 10-year period of time. And what that means is that for the $40,000 that you've borrowed, you know, $15,000 is going to be paid as interest over that 10-year period of time. So it's $55,000 for $40,000 of education. And I think the thing that's important is the student needs to make sure that their degree is truly a marketable degree that they're going to be able to make a nice income with before you enter into that debt. So that's the caution I would give.
Good. Well, I trust that you're watching and you're paying close attention to this, because this can save. You know, as one that has served the church in the community, the number one reason why divorces happen in America is out of financial pressures and debts. So we're talking about the very issues that impact us at every level of our lives. Well, let's move on, because there's so many things that we need to talk about. Let's talk about mortgages before we take a break. What's your thought on mortgages, please?
Well, we've talked a little bit about that already and the importance of not getting in over your head.
Okay.
And there's a thing called a second mortgage as well, where people can have a mortgage on their property and they can go get a home equity line of credit. And people sometimes don't remember or don't forget that that home equity line of credit is secured by your home, your residence.
Yeah.
And if you default on that, they can come in and take your home away as well. So when you're playing in the mortgage category, you really have to remember you're playing with your primary residence as collateral for these loans. And if you default in any way, the bank will take ownership and you'll lose everything in your home.
Wow. Well, we're talking with Charlie Fitzgerald, who is a certified financial planner, and he is taking us through some very comprehensive thought processes about our mortgage, about student loans, about debt. It's so important, friend, that you take this to heart, because this could change your life. And I do believe with my whole heart that God wants us to understand that we are stewards of the resource that He gives to us. So it's not just about the bank. It's not just about something that's happening in the future, but it is happening right now, and it will affect our lives. We're going to take just a quick break, and we're going to come back. We're going to continue our conversation with Charlie. He's going to help us to talk about a few more issues that are really significant to personal debt. So you stay with us. We'll be back in just about 30 seconds.
When it comes to your money, whatever you want to get smart about, you can find at smartaboutmoney.org. Smart About Money is a free online resource. We are a non-commercial, non-profit organization dedicated to helping people just like you get information about money. For everything from how to build an emergency fund to how to deal with job uncertainty, smartaboutmoney.org has the answers you've been looking for. Smartaboutmoney.org, the easy place to start when you want to get smart about your finances.
Welcome back to Joy in Our Town, and we're so delighted you're here. I'm George Cope. I've been your host for the last 15 minutes, and it's my privilege to welcome to our set today Charlie Fitzgerald. Charlie is a financial planner. He's certified. He is a graduate of the University of Florida. He attended UCF. You know, go Gators, go Knights, you know, so we're going to have to get that in. But in the process, Charlie, it is really good to sit and talk with somebody that's logical and practical about finances, because I think that we become so emotional in the process of spending and borrowing and this whole idea. At least I know that I can get caught up in the midst of that. Here's something that no one really talked to me about when I was growing up, and I'm a long way from being the person you need to be talking to. Fortunately, I've had time to make some changes. Savings. Nobody ever talked to me about a savings account. When I was a young person and first getting married, I've been married 45 years. Thank God I married a frugal woman. So talk to us about savings. Why is saving so important?
Well, savings is what I would describe as the first order of self-government.
Wow, that's an interesting. Say that again. It's the first.
One of the first orders of self-government. The ability to live within your means.
Okay.
The ability to do basic math and say, this is what I make, these are my taxes that I'm going to pay, and then I've got this much left to spend. And as a part of that, saving, having your savings be part of your budget, where you're systematically putting money away and building some reserves. Right now, in the United States, 73% of Americans don't have $1,000 in a savings account.
Wow, 73%.
73%. And one-third of your high-income earners, those that are making $75,000 and above, are living paycheck to paycheck. So those are kind of shocking numbers. And I think that, you know, our society, it's pretty materialistic, and people want to have this and have that, and money is easy to come into contact with, as you know, credit cards and such. And people can easily get in over their head. And I don't think people intentionally are getting themselves in over their head, but they, by not saving, they're, you know, doing the opposite, right? So it's deferral of immediate gratification. It's being able to say, okay, I would like that, but I'm going to wait, and I'm going to save until I have the money to buy that. Yeah. It's the importance of savings.
So to put it sort of in practical terms, you're telling us to not be emotional when we go out with a credit card. In the process, we
That's
go out.
That's not a good combination.
It's not a good,
no.
Yeah.
Emotions and credit cards.
It's like going to the grocery store hungry, right? You buy everything and then you get home and it's not the case. Well, if that's, how does the American saving rate look then? What are you, help us to go a little bit further in this whole deal. How do American savings rates stack up and look, and how do I deal with that and our viewers today?
Well, the Americans aren't doing that great in the savings category, unfortunately. Now, in the 1960s, back in, when I was born, you know, eons ago, Americans were saving 10 to 15% per year. Not bad. In fact, that's very good. And over the last 50 years, Americans are now saving about 5% of their income, which is not very good. The average country out there is about 10%. And Ireland, about 19% saving rate in Ireland.
Why? Is there any
maybe
reasoning for that?
It's all those Fitzgeralds over there in Ireland.
Oh, you're like taking credit for it. Yes. Okay, good. Well, what about seniors? Are seniors in? Because I know, you know, I'm about the 65 age. Mm-hmm. I'll be the soon, and I'm getting all the information about Social Security. So. We can't depend on Social Security, can we?
Well, that's another unfortunate thing. Of our 44 million seniors in the United States, one third of them are entirely dependent upon Social Security.
Wow.
And if it wasn't for Social Security, what would be happening to these one third, for the 14 million seniors, okay, what would they be doing if it wasn't for Social Security? And it's unfortunate that that's the case, but I think it has to be a wake-up call to everyone to realize we've got to be putting money away, we've got to be saving, we have to be investing for our futures, not just for, you know, the expense tomorrow, but we have to be looking out, you know, 5 years, 10, even 30 years, when you're young.
Yeah, I don't have a finance degree, but I understand compounding interest.
Right.
Could you explain that to people, why savings then works so wonderful for them if they started doing it at what age, and what could they anticipate as they grow old?
You know, this is one of my favorite topics to talk about with young people. And a couple weeks ago, I had the opportunity to address about 30 of our young adults in our church here in Orlando. And one of the lessons I had in there was this thing called the Rule of 72. And I won't get into the technical calculation of that, but basically what the rule says, if you are investing in, let's say, the stock market, where, believe it or not, the stock market does make about 10% per year, and it has made that for, 100 years. If you're making 10% per year, your money will double every 7.2 years, to be precise. So let's say 7 years, you see a double of your money. If you're 20 years old and you have $1,000 and you're in a stock market investment and you're making 10%, then that 1,000 will grow to 2,000 by the time you're 27. If you go out 7 more years, the 2,000 goes to 4, 4 goes to 8, to 16, to 32, to 64. By age 69, the 20-year-old, after 49 years of savings, that 1,000 would have grown to $128,000. That's on the $1,000 investment.
So no more than that, just
nothing
the $1,000.
Nothing else added. Now, let's say that young saver puts $1,000 a year in. Now, do the math, and you end up at age 69 with an excess of $1 million that's been saved by putting just $1,000 a year away, earning at 10%.
Wow.
So the numbers are phenomenal. If you can, especially if you get started early, it doesn't take a lot to really achieve wealth and financial security in your golden years.
Well, that's what I'm talking to my grandkids about now, because I want them to not suffer the same mistake.
And on that point, one thing you can do to help them out is to open up an account for them and begin to get savings started with them. I did this with my three kids. We opened up a Uniform Transfer to Minors Act account. It's called a UTMA account at a local discount brokerage. We put some money in there, got them into some stock mutual funds, and they're already seeing really nice growth on their money, and they're learning because they have their own account. So that's something you can do as a grandfather for your grandchildren.
Okay, so you've mentioned stocks a couple of times. Let's talk about that for a moment, because I'm sure that there are folk that have investments of stock in that. The market you have to understand it a little bit. So is the stock market for quick turnaround or for long term?
Well, the answer is easy. It's long term.
Okay.
Yeah, if anybody has the thought of putting money in the stock market and pulling it out within a 5-year period of time, thinking I'm going to invest it for a couple years and turn around and take it right out, I would encourage them highly, do not do that. Stock markets, as we have seen and we know, can take a severe downturn. And when that happens, it may take 3 or 4 or 5 years for it to recover. So if you're looking to invest and you can leave the money in there for at least 5 years, is what I tell folks, then you know, you're probably fine to be in the stock market. But if you need the money for less than 5 years, I wouldn't recommend being in stocks.
So if they are going to need it for five, what would you recommend them to talk to a financial planner about? Are there accounts and funds and that they can put it in for the 5 years so they could have liquidity to it?
Exactly.
Okay.
Yeah. So there's kind of three stages of investing. You have the short term category, you have the intermediate term category, and this long term category.
Okay. So are there ages to those categories, or is it just the way you're thinking about the money you want to?
I think it's the way you're thinking.
Okay.
Yeah. So
okay.
The first category is going to be money that you might have to touch within a 1 year period of time.
Okay.
Money that maybe you don't have to touch for 5 years is an intermediate. And then money that's 5 years and greater, 5, 10, whatever, that would be kind of your long-term money. And how you handle each of those accounts is going to be unique and different. You're not going to want to put stocks in your emergency fund that you need where you could tap into that in the next year, right? So mostly money market and savings accounts for your short money. Your intermediate money, I would think CDs or bond funds are fine. And then when you're looking at money you can let invest for 5 years and greater, then I think you start looking at diversified stock mutual funds, things like that.
Okay, good. Well, that's helpful, because I think sometimes we sort of try to pigeonhole people, and it's what works for you where you're at your point in life and what you have and what you need for that particular process.
It gets to the goals of what the person's trying to accomplish. If you're trying to accumulate money for a down payment on a house, I wouldn't have you put that in the stock market, because you're probably buying a house in the next 5 years. So put that in something a little more conservative.
Good.
So, yeah.
Well, I've been asking you the question, so I'm going to ask you sort of an open-ended. What's your favorite topic on investing?
Well, I kind of touched the topic already, and that was the rule of 72.
Okay.
But I will say there is one topic that I do want to also make sure our viewers understand. That's the importance of not trying to time the stock market. A lot of people think that, you know, hey, you're the professional. You know when the market's going to go down. You know when the market's going to go up. So get me out before it goes down and get me in before it goes up so I can make money. Mm-hmm. And the reality is there's no predicting the stock market any more than you or me predicting the headline of the news in the next week or two or three.
For sure.
It's just an uncertain world. Over long term, the stock markets work, and they produce wealth, and they make money. But over short term, it's really anybody's guess. It's random.
Okay. So we just need to be sensible when we move into that.
That's
well,
right.
We've got just a few minutes left, Charlie. So I want to get practical, because I think that what happens, we talk general. So we now need some advice. Mm-hmm. So would you give us some next steps for our viewers in going forward in saving and investing so that they would be able to take this conversation and know what they should do with it so that they can be good stewards of what God has put in their hands?
Well, I think the first thing is to have a plan.
Okay.
Some people just, they don't plan to fail. They just fail to plan. You've heard that before.
I have.
So it's putting a plan together, and maybe just simply putting a budget together and looking at what your monthly expenses are and trying to live within your means. The second thing I would advise viewers is to put together an emergency fund. We've already shown that the average American doesn't have anything really sitting on the side. And that should be the financial planning 101 rule, is to have at least 3 to 6 months of your budget, of your monthly needs, in a savings account that you can draw upon if you need, because something happens. And then if you have to tap that account, replenish it, you know, before you go on. And then the final thing I would recommend would be the importance of using your 401k plan. Right now, 80% of the companies in the U.S. have 401ks, and about 80% of the employees participate in them. And so I would encourage viewers to participate in your 401k plan and begin to learn a little bit about investments and accumulate some money for yourself long term.
And maybe you can come back sometime when we talk about the whole idea of these finances, not only personally, but God has placed them in our hands to be stewards in His kingdom as well. Yep. And so I don't want anyone to forget that we're not talking just about what's mine. We're reminding ourselves that God has blessed us. In fact, when we pray for our meal and when we pray together as a family, I want to always bless the hand that is provided. Yes. The hand of God is the provider. And we never want to forget the fact that He's the giver of every good and perfect gift. So what we have, again, we're going to have to give account to. And I think that it's really important that in the day in which we live, people take strong emphasis. Is there a book out there that you could recommend or something? Have you read anything recently that people might want to pick up and say, hey, this would help me in my personal finance?
There is. There's one book that I've read that kind of changed my world when it comes to personal finance, and it's a book written by Randy Alcorn called Money, Possessions, and Eternity. And I read this book about 25 years ago. We actually walked through it as a small group. Well, my wife and I have been doing a small group in our church for over 20 years now. And we walked our home group through this book, and what he says in there really is amazing. It does put our finances in proper perspective, that we are really stewards of what He's given us. But that would be a book that I would highly
recommend. So give us the name one more time.
Money, Possessions, and Eternity, Randy Alcorn.
Randy Alcorn.
Yes, very good book.
Let's end with that. I just want you to know that, again, TBN is concerned about the whole man, that we are spirit, we are soul, and we are body. And so God wants us to take precious care of all three of those. And so today we've talked about the soul, the way we think about our finance. Friend, I want you to know that God loves you, He cares, He has blessed you with resource, and He wants you to use it wisely. So Joy in Our Town is going to talk about these kinds of issues that will help you in practical ways. I want to thank you on behalf of TBN for joining us today. Thanks, Charlie, for joining us.
You're welcome.
May God bless. Have a great week in Jesus, and we'll see you again.
This program has been sponsored by the Trinity Broadcasting Network, Post Office Box A, Santa Ana, California, 92711.